welcome Larry Mitchell.
Thank you, Bill. I guess y'all can hear me okay?
Can somebody get the lights?
All right, I want to thank you guys for coming out. I'm going to try to run through this as quickly as I can. I usually run out of time on these presentations, so I'll try and get it done as quickly as possible today. This year's program started with last year's program on observing the Markarian galaxies. I kept running across a name, Victor Ambartsumian, that seemed to be the driver of everything that was done from that, at the time, that Russian observatory. And I hope you'll agree with me that by the end of this presentation that the amount of work that's been turned out at Byurakan is absolutely phenomenal. It's incredible. And most of the amateur society, the people don't know about this body of work because most of it was done during the Cold War when there was mutual distrust on both sides between Soviet Russia and the United States. So for that reason, a lot of their work was really unknown over here. So I'm going to try to make you guys aware of some of that from a historical perspective as well as some of the science that was done. To me, the knowledge that we have of astronomy today is very exciting, but the way that we determined and learned that knowledge is equally exciting, and much of that work was done at Byurakan. Observing program, the advanced observing program, is not intended to make people go out and buy big telescopes. It is intended to get people with small to medium-sized telescopes to look at objects that they might not think that they can see. And when they give it a shot, they actually can observe these objects. A big part of what we're trying to do is to educate, to know what you're looking at. Don't just look at some faint fuzzy thing and then go on to the next faint fuzzy thing. Know something about the object that you're looking at. That makes it much more interesting. Also improve your observing skills. Learn how to star hop rather than punching something up on a computer. If you can find it, if you can star hop to the object and you do it more than one time, chances are you can throw that star chart away and you can do it on your own. And you can also find it on anyone else's telescope. So it's much better when you star hop. And additionally, you know where in the sky that object is, what constellation it is in. And you learn to observe and see objects that are barely brighter than the sky background. And the last thing is learn patience, which is something I had to learn myself and still am. But if you don't see that object tonight, try it another night because the sky background varies tremendously. So if you don't see it tonight, give it a shot tomorrow night and you might be surprised how well you can see it the very next night. And the last thing is have fun. We're not in a race to see everything tonight. It'll be here tomorrow or next week. Just learn to enjoy yourself. But this is what we're trying to do with the Advanced Observing Program. Before I go any further, though, I've got a couple of thank yous to make. Our moderator, Bill Flanagan, made it possible for me to have the 36-inch telescope here this year. The motor drive completely failed on me, and Bill came over to my house and put a lot of work, a lot of time, a lot of effort, did a wonderful job in getting the telescope to working properly, which the motor drive part is working properly now. And we went out to our site at Columbus. I found Bill is an excellent observer. He can see these little faint, fuzzy objects with the best of them. So I want to thank you very much, Bill, right here. Thank you very much. Yeah, he did a good job. And then next, I have been in contact with some of the astronomers at Byurakan. They have been very, very supportive, very thankful that I'm giving this presentation. Dr. Vahi Petrosian is a well-known expert on cometary nebula and in active galaxies. He is a co-discoverer of gravitational lenses. He is currently working at Sanford University, and I had several emails from him regarding answering some specific questions that I've had. Dr. McCallion has been just absolutely wonderful. He's answered a lot of questions I had. He is currently one of the leading research scientists at Byurakan. He is in charge of the Victor Ambartsumian International Prize, which I will cover shortly. And he's the author of 162 scientific publications. He's in charge of the digitized version of the Markarian Galaxy Survey. And he is a very, very busy man, travels the world giving lectures and doing research at various observatories. So both of these people have been very, very helpful to me in being able to present this program today. There's Dr. McCallion and Dr. Petrosian together over in Byurakan. These are the pins that we've given out. This year's pin, that is Victor Ambartsumian, his face in the center. All of these pins were done by Amelia's daughter. She does a wonderful, wonderful job every year. And this was not an easy one to make because I gave her a photograph and she came back with that, which was just incredible. So this is what we're giving out this year. So far I've handed out 15 pins for this year's observing list, and I've handed 2 pins out from last year. And there's probably some more that, since I had to turn in early last night, there's probably some more pins that people got last night. I have a good supply of all of these pins. If you folks want to do one of the previous year's observing programs, I've got the handouts for all the previous years as well. And if you've already done this year's, you can start in and do some of the other years. This year's observing list is, you guys are fooling me again. I thought the list was going to be pretty difficult. Walt Cooney did it in about 4 hours. He was the first one to do the list. Matt Delavorius has done it again with his 8-inch telescope. I just handed him out a pen just a few minutes ago. He's done every single one of them with an 8-inch telescope. So these lists are certainly doable in smaller telescopes. For the people that have done all of them, the first 10 years, I have one large shirt left. For 15-year pins, which is this one, people that have done all of the first 15 years, I've got 4 large and 2 extra large T-shirts left. And when they're gone, they're gone. That's all that I've got left. But there's quite a few of these out that I've handed out. And those of you that are here that have your T-shirt, wear them Saturday night because I want to recognize you. All right, this is the list, and I've kind of made it where you have to do some work on your own to figure out which are the brighter and which are the dimmer objects. Don't necessarily go by the apparent magnitude. These apparent magnitudes are G-band magnitudes, which is 4,303 angstroms. Our eyes see 5,300 angstrom light. So this is in the blue part of the spectrum. So these magnitudes are too bright. So you kind of want to not really go by that so much, but you want to look at absolute magnitude and your surface brightness, and I'll go over that in just a second. But with any magnitude, the lower the number, the brighter the object. So here we have a high surface brightness object I determined in my telescope, and Arakelian 293 is a low surface brightness object. So if you look at the absolute magnitude, minus 20th is fainter than minus 22nd. This is a higher surface brightness object. If you go to the surface brightness, the absolute surface brightness, which is 1 square arc second sliver of this the object you're looking at, a 23rd magnitude object is going to be fainter than a 22nd magnitude object. So those are the kind of things that you want to look for. Look at the absolute and look at the surface brightness. Additionally, you want to look at size. You want to look at the class. An SO, lenticular, an elliptical galaxy will always be brighter than a spiral galaxy. Spiral galaxy has a bright core, but the arms are much fainter. An elliptical galaxy is a big ball of light. So that will give you a good indication that an elliptical galaxy will be necessarily brighter than a spiral galaxy. So you need to look at these things and also look at your co-moving radial distances as well. Your more distant galaxies typically should be fainter and of a lower surface brightness. So you have to do a little work to determine which is the object that you want to look at. In order to determine absolute magnitude, you need to know what a parsec is. And typically, it's using one astronomical unit from the Earth's orbit from 1 6-month period to the next out to what subtends one arc second. How far out do we go to get a one arc second angle? And that works out to be about 3.26 light years, 3.26168 light years to be exact, or 19 trillion miles, which is easy to remember because that's what our national debt is now, so unfortunately. So a parsec is nothing more than how far we have to go out to get one arc second angle and 3.26 light years. 10 of those is 32.6 light years, and that happens to be what an absolute magnitude distance is. How bright is something at 10 parsecs, at 32.6 light years out? How bright would that object, its apparent brightness, be? If we're looking at straight apparent magnitude, we're taking objects this big and shrinking them down to a stellar number, integrated magnitude. So that is not always extremely accurate, and it's usually in a different bandwidth than what our visual, our eyesight is. And it's strictly determined by luminosity and distance. So if we look at Canis Major, this is what it looks like to the regular eye. But if we go by absolute magnitudes, this is what it would look like. This is what the stars would look like at a distance of 32.6 light years. And that is a very good scale to go by here. And again, the lowest number, the lowest minus number, is the brightest object. Apparent magnitude versus absolute magnitude. Our sun has an apparent magnitude of minus 26. Our full moon is minus 12. Sirius is minus 1.5 in apparent magnitude. Absolute magnitude, our sun, it says 4.83. You usually see it listed as 4.75, absolute magnitude. But look at a quasar. People don't realize how energetic a quasar is. A quasar's absolute magnitude is about minus 26. The sun's apparent magnitude is minus 26. What that means is if we had a quasar 32.6 light years from here, we would have perpetual daylight sunlight, night and day. That quasar would light our sky up just like the sun does. So these objects, when we say that these M87 is minus 22, when we say these objects are active galactic nuclei, that is extremely active, very powerful. And these are what the scientists at Byurakan were studying and what you guys are looking at, the Arakelian galaxies and the Cassarian galaxies. The mean surface brightness, and I'll go over this real quickly, but when we're taking a one arc second squared section of a galaxy, and if it's close, it's a bigger portion. If it's further out, well, it goes by the square of the distance, and the size of the square arc second increases proportionately. So it doesn't matter if the object is near or if it's far, the surface brightness will stay the same. And which is why surface brightness is an excellent thing to go by, because on a night that your sky background is 18th magnitude, for instance, and you're trying to see a 20th magnitude galaxy, surface brightness-wise, you'll never see it because it's fainter than the sky background. This is why we only see the core of some galaxies, because the spiral arms are fainter than the absolute magnitude of or the apparent surface brightness of the background, they're fainter than that, so we don't see those spiral arms. So you want to pay close attention to surface brightness. It's very important, and for looking at galaxies, it's really more important than visual magnitude or apparent magnitude. And this is another area that the Byurakan astronomers, particularly Eric Helian, excelled at, and they were right. The handouts that I've got up here, and we meant to hand these out, but I've got a bunch of copies. You guys help yourself, you know, take a copy. But I've got some information on each object, and some of these objects are very, there's not a lot of literature written about them. They're very obscure objects. So I found what I could. You want to read about the object. Each object is unique. When you know something about that object, it makes it an interesting object. And I've used the professional journals, the astrophysical journals, astronomy journals for the reference on these handouts, the information that you find there. All right, where is Armenia? Armenia is a landlocked country located between Turkey and Azerbaijan, just north of Iran. It is a relatively poor country, but it is known for one thing, and that's astronomy. Dr. Mikaelian said they're not known for their sports, they're not known for their theater, they're not known for their art, they're not known for anything except astronomy. And that they excel. This observatory, in my opinion, has turned out more science than any observatory in the world. But a little bit about the place. Yerevan is the capital city. It has a little over a million people there. And it's located on the slope of Mount Aragats, which is where Byurakan is located as well. This is the main entrance to the university. And this is the Ambartsumian Museum there. And the museum has about 10,000 students. And Ambartsumian started the astrophysics department. He said it's an observational science for which observational data are of dominant importance. And he's the man that got everything started at the university. As far as Byurakan goes, there's the observatory. It's in the middle of the town. It's quite amazing place. The largest telescope is 102-inch diameter telescope. Ambartsumian was the guiding light as far as getting the observatory started. He founded it in 1946. In something like 1996, they changed the name of the observatory to Victor Ambartsumian Observatory. Under his guidance, he started a lot of different projects, but basically they study what they call unstable objects. Non-stationary objects, flare stars, active galactic nuclei, stellar associations, and nebulae. And in all of these areas, they excel. They've discovered over 1,000 flare stars, dozens of supernova, hundreds of Herbig-Haro objects, hundreds of cometary nebula. They've got catalogs on these things, thousands and thousands of galaxies, special star clusters and stellar associations, which Ambartsumian discovered himself. The largest telescope, the 102-inch telescope, is used extensively. The one, what they call the 1 meter Schmidt telescope, is the most famous telescope over there. However, this is the one that Markarian surveys were done with. And that is Benjamin Markarian at the controls of the telescope itself. This is the largest telescope to have a full aperture objective prism, which is how they did the Markarian surveys with. This is the large radio dish. Ambartsumian started them on radio observing in 1950, and they put this started construction in 1975. This is a 177-foot dish buried into the ground in front of the hotel there at Byurakan. The smaller telescopes are for For young people, yes. It is the mirror is 52 inches. The corrector plate is 40, and based on that, they call it a 1 meter. They do a lot of work with children. They have school kids coming in, literally from all over the world, and they use these telescopes. So they try to promote science, promote astronomy as much as possible. In the summer months, it gets quite cold over there in the wintertime. But when available, they're constantly working on educating the public on astronomy. Dr. McCallion gave me this. Since the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991, the observatory has come on hard times. They don't get the funding like other observatories do. Some of the telescopes have had to go inactive for periods of time. But yet, these are some of the projects that have been accomplished there since the year 2000. And Dr. McCallion was kind enough to send me this, and he said to stress to the folks that work is still going on to this day at Byurakan. And as a matter of fact, they've got 52 scientific staff at the moment, and they're currently working on 97 large and small projects. So work continues. Armenia was part of the Soviet Union until 1991, and now Armenia is on its own. It is a separate country. It's no longer part of Russia, except they still do a lot of work with the Russians. They also do a lot of work with the Tanitzetlia Observatory in Mexico. They seem to have a very good, close working relationship with that observatory as well. All right, Victor Ambartsumian. I'm going to go into some detail. This man was one of the true geniuses of the 20th century. He's up there with Einstein. He was a child protege. The man was absolutely brilliant. Yet those of us in amateur circles anyway know very little about the work of this wonderful person. I mean, he was just incredible. At the age of 16, he was lecturing at Yerevan University to the professors on Einstein's theory of relativity because they were having trouble with the math. So they brought this 16-year-old kid in to explain it to him. And he was a math wizard. At the age of 18, he published his first scientific paper. At the age of 21, he lectured on the quantization of space, which is something Halton Arp has been working on and still hasn't been, a solution hasn't been made until this day. He also wrote a famous paper that atomic nuclei could not include protons and electrons in the nucleus. 3 years later, the neutron was discovered. The electron was put in its proper place, in orbit around the center. This 21-year-old kid had already come up with the math to prove that. At the age of 28, he founded and headed the astrophysics chair at Leningrad University. 28 years old, he's in charge of astrophysics at a major university. Age of 31, he was director of the Leningrad University Observatory. He wrote a textbook at the age of 31, Theoretical Astrophysics, which is the first book ever of its kind and content. So this was how he got his start. And people just flocked to him to learn. I asked Dr. Kasarian, what was he like as a man, as a person? Because I've got a book about him, but it doesn't say anything about Ambartsumian. Kasarian said he was one of the nicest people you'd ever meet. He said he was very humble. He was easy to work with, had a great sense of humor. He was beloved by everyone. And he did his work during the Soviet-Russia time period. He was a member of the Communist Party. There was a distrust amongst people in the West of people from the Soviets, and they distrusted us. Well, Ambartsumian was such a diplomat that he was elected president of the International Astronomical Union. That's incredible. That's incredible because the Soviets weren't looked upon in that regard, but Ambartsumian was able to get get people to trust him enough to do that. Some of the areas of expertise that he did, he was a renowned expert in astrophysics, mathematics, and theoretical physics. He solved something called the Sturm-Liouville inverse problem, which is calculating what happens with a vibrating string. And it was considered not solvable. When he was 20 years old, he solved it. And that made him famous right there, because it was not considered up to that time to be a math problem that could be solved. But then he went on. Structure of atomic nuclei. Determined the age of our galaxy. Star formation, which was completely backwards at the time. Distribution of stellar velocity, molecular clouds, flaring objects, stellar associations. He got great acclaim for that. Evolution of galaxies, activity of galactic nuclei was probably his greatest contribution. Theory of radiative transfer, pulsar work, gaseous nebula, all of these he was considered somewhat an expert. Most astronomers would be happy to be considered an expert in one of these fields. This man was considered an expert in all of this. He was famous in his own time. Here he is with Nikita Khrushchev. Jan Oort was Ambart Sumian's hero. He considered Oort his protege, his mentor. Viktor Sobolev was a famous Russian scientist. He was a student of Ambart Sumian. Here he is conducting a symposium. They had stamps made of him in his own time. He was a famous man in his own time. His lectures were widely attended. He could make the most complicated mathematical equation understood by his audience, and his people appreciated him for that. He could take very complicated issues and explain them in a way that anyone could understand. In the 30s, he laid the foundation for the physics of stellar shells and gaseous nebula. He was the first to explain that planetary nebula really are expanding. He wrote a famous paper, The Dynamical Dissolution of a Star, where he wrote that the planetary results from the ejection of the outer layer of stars, because they really didn't know where these things came from. This is back in the 30s, before they knew about fusion and radioactivity, and the stars were formed out of hydrogen mainly. They called galaxies nebula in those times. They didn't even know that whether they were in our Milky Way galaxy or out. So back in the 30s and the 40s, there was a lot to be yet learned. And some of these areas he was a pioneer in. The relative equilibrium of planetary nebula, where he determined the mass of the gas shell for the first time. And this was a famous paper that he did in 1933. He did the same thing with Nova. He was able to determine the mass of the Nova expulsion shell and explained why that expansion was going on. Back in those days, most people thought that things happening in the universe were a result of contraction, not expansion. And Ambart Sumian was able to determine that most evolutionary processes in the universe are not due to contraction, but rather due to expansion. And he based his whole career on this theory of expansion. He also was the first to determine that interstellar matter, when we look up in our Milky Way galaxy, that those are gas clouds composed of particles and not gaseous material. Interstellar matter occurs in the form of clouds, which at the time they did not know that. It was an entirely new concept that he put forth, and that the absorption in our galaxy is due to those clouds and not due to the interaction of gaseous components. And he said that there's roughly 2,000 times more of these clouds than we knew about at the time, and he was correct. Stellar associations is one of the areas that he got his most famous acclaim. He discovered the stellar associations and the whole concept of it. Up until the middle of the 20th century, the predominant opinion was that stars in our galaxy were created simultaneously many billions of years ago, and they were currently only evolving. Ambert Sumian came up with this idea of stellar associations, and he was able to prove that stars are forming in our own epoch, in our own time frame. There's young stars, middle-aged, and old stars. They didn't all just form sometime back when and going through evolutionary process. His discovery of this new type of stellar associations was revolutionary, and he ran into some problems. His mentor, Jan Oort, didn't believe him. Chandra Sekhar did not believe him. Alan Sandage did not believe him. Some of the giants in astronomy thought he was nuts. They all went and apologized to him later because he was absolutely correct. He was also trying to explain the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, the HR diagram, and they had that all backwards. For those of you that don't know what one is, this is a HR diagram. This is the main, what we call the main sequence. Well, before Ambart Sumian clued them in on stellar evolution, they thought that stars formed big, like red giants, and they condensed and came down the main sequence this way to smaller stars. And since they didn't know about fusion, they thought the heat from the stars was due to gravitational collapse. And if they mathematically calculated that out, a star would only live a few tens of millions of years. Yet they're standing on the Earth that we knew was billions of years old. So they knew there was a problem with the HR diagram, with the reverse evolutionary process, but they couldn't explain it until Ambert Sumian came along with his theory of stellar evolution and properly had stars going up the HR diagram the way that we know today that they really do. In the 40s, he proved these stellar associations were expanding systems. He proved that they are young. He proved that they cannot stay long. Being young, members of these clusters with young gravitational attractions and the flaring that goes on with these stars, that they could not stay in these stellar associations long, so the associations themselves had to be young objects. He did a lot of work with dense protostars, which were throwing off massive amounts of material, and he was able to calculate the stellar mass that was being thrown out from these young T-Tauri, type stars. He did a lot of revolutionary work with this, and in 1950 he was given the Stalin Award for his work with stellar associations. Flare stars, which are associated with the stellar associations, he presented for the first time that these protostars, which he named them, were extremely dense, super dense protostellar matter, early unstable phase of star formation, and that these T-Tauri stars produce these Herbig-Haro objects, which are objects that were ejected out of the stars. Again, this has to do with his expansion, his ejection of material from stars and from matter. The universe is expanding and not contracting, which is what people had thought before he came up with these new ideas. Radio galaxies had just been discovered back in the 40s, and he proved statistically that radio galaxies could not happen due to a collision. These lobes were not colliding. They weren't colliding inward due to gravitational collapse of this. They were actually expanding outward. And he mathematically, statistically proved that it had to be expanding, that it was an early stage of stellar development in the galaxy itself. He ran into some problems initially with some of his fellow colleagues in this regard as well. Where he has got his most acclaim was his extragalactic astronomy, the work that he did with galaxies itself. before his publication that that he did in a series of paper. It was assumed that galactic nuclei are fully formed systems with a rich past, and they wouldn't change radically in the future. The core of these galaxies had formed billions of years ago, and nothing had changed. Everything was working along very peacefully. Well, he found that wasn't right, but he wasn't the first one to think this. The first galaxy that they had a problem with was M77. Edward Arthur Fath at Lick Observatory in 1908 took a spectrum of M77 and saw some lines that he had never seen before. All galaxies have absorption lines. The stars are putting out radiation that's absorbed by the gas and the clouds in that galaxy, which is then re-emitted. So absorption lines are common in all galaxies, but galaxies aren't supposed to have emission lines. How do you explain an emission line in a galaxy? Planetary nebula have emission lines because they're exploding. They're expanding outward. They're emitting a tremendous amount of radiation and energy. But how does a galaxy do that? It was totally perplexing. 1907, M83 was discovered. 1918, they were discovering these galaxies that had these weird emission lines one at a time. 1942, Carl Seyfert, who was given credit for the Seyfert emission galaxies. Well, at the time, there were six known. He wrote about six more that had not been known. And I've got a copy of his paper. He doesn't call them galaxies. He calls them nebulae. These are nebulae with emission lines that are moving, hydrogen lines are moving at a high rate of speed. The lines are very wide. They're moving around the center at a high rate of speed, and that's as far as he went with it. Didn't try to explain what was causing these emission lines to be Doppler shifted, to be widened at the base. Radio galaxies in 1949 were discovered. Cygnus A was discovered by Botta and Minkowski. Again, emission lines. They didn't know what was going on here. Well, in 1954, Ambert Soumian came up with a radical conclusion. Galaxies are not taking place. Collision is not taking place in galaxies, which is causing these spectral shifts, which is what they thought. They thought galaxies were colliding, and that was causing the emission shift in the lines. Ambert Soumian said rather explosions are taking place in these galaxies. And he did a lot of research on it, but he was kind of in doubt as to what was going on because everybody else was telling him he was wrong. But when he looked at NGC 3561 and he saw that little blivet right there, which he called a densification, which we know it as Ambert Soumian's knot, he knew he was right. He knew that galaxies were expelling material at a very energetic, explosive pace. Again, he was roundly criticized by Oort, by the leading astronomers of the day. They told him that this just cannot be happening. It was impossible. But he decided that if they knew about these 15 or 20 galaxies with emission line structures, there must be more of them out there. And he sat down with Benjamin Markarian, and they decided to start looking for these things. And that was the Markarian surveys that you guys were looking at last year. as a matter of fact, they went out and discovered over 4,000 of the things. So it was quite revolutionary what they did. Ambert Soumian's knot. This is NGC 3561. The knot is here at the bottom. This is a SA peculiar spiral galaxy that is being torn apart by this massive elliptical galaxy here. This elliptical galaxy is throwing material out. Ambart-Sumian's knot is coming out of the spiral galaxy. This plume is coming out of the elliptical galaxy. This plume is 325,000 light years long. I might point out to you our nearest star is 4.3 light years away. So it'll give you some idea of how energetic that that plume and that object is. Ambart-Sumian's knot is visible on a night of good seeing, like we had night before last, in relatively small telescopes. I've seen it in 18 and 20 inch telescopes, my 36 inch telescopes. About a year ago, I had a night on the mountain with an 82 inch telescope on a night of bad seeing, and we barely could see Ambart-Sumian's knot on a night of bad seeing in an 82 inch telescope. So you need good seeing to see these things. And with a good sky, like we had a couple of nights ago, you can see that. I didn't include it in this year's advanced list because we've done it, I think, on two different times on previous lists. So I left it off. It's faint. This whole structure is faint. This galaxy structure is over 300 around what 413 light years distance. So it's a fairly good distance away. But this was key to Ambart-Sumian finding that galaxies really do expel material explosively from the core regions. In the 50s and the 60s, he devoted most all of his time to this. And he introduced for the first time the ideas that the nuclei of galaxies are active, they are explosive, and they have gas outflows, which is collimated burst of satellite material. AGNs, or active galactic nuclei, have a decisive role in the birth and evolution of galaxies. He proved that galaxies are being formed in our own lifetime, that they didn't just form in the beginning and have been quietly evolving, that they are actively being formed as we speak in our own epoch, in our own time. That was very radical. Blue compact dwarfs, such as Ambart-Sumian's knot, are some of the best places to study star formation processes, young stars, which was radical until he came up with the idea. And when they discovered quasars in the 60s, I mean, that, if anything, wouldn't have sealed it, quasars did, because they're throwing out tremendous amount of material and energy from the center of these objects. So again, this led to the Byurakan, the first Byurakan survey, which we know as the Markarian survey. In 1952, in Solvay, or the Solvay Conference in Liege, Belgium. This was a very, very famous lecture in front of a lot of famous people, which you can see there. These are the people that were at that conference. He gave his talk on the evolution of galaxies. At the time, it was considered groundbreaking. Someone wrote that it was Copernican revolutionary groundbreaking. It was so radical because, again, up to then, they thought galaxies and this activity was due to contraction. And he was able to prove that no, it's due to expansion. Enormous explosions take place in galactic nuclei, and as a result, a huge amount of mass is expelled. A galaxy was considered active if any one of the following activities was observed. Ejection of gaseous matter, such as Virgo A, M82, efflux of relativistic particles, particles moving at or near the speed of light, radio bursts, converting a galaxy into a radio galaxy, and lastly but not leastly, ejection of compact blue condensations, similar to Ambart-Sumian's knot in NGC 3561. Several people, as mentioned, had negative views, including Oort, Sandage, Chandrasekhar. They all came back and told him he was right. As a matter of fact, Oort wrote a big paper on mass ejection from our Milky Way galaxy a few years later. completely changed his way of thinking about galaxies and galactic evolution. Today, we have the Victor Ambartsumian Prize, of which Dr. Michaelian is in charge of. It's one of the most important international awards in astronomy, astrophysics, and related sciences. And the winner is awarded $500,000 every 2 years. This award is given out, and the winner will be decided this coming July 18th. It's awarded to outstanding scientists who've made significant contributions in physical and mathematical sciences from any country and of any nationality. It's difficult to be even considered for this, but recipients of it, beyond the money, it's a high award to have, the Victor Ambartsumian Award. He has written a total of 7 books. The 3 most famous books is the one that I mentioned is Textbook of Theoretical Astrophysics, Problems of Modern Cosmogony, How We Got Here, specifically and mainly our solar system, and then Philosophical Problems of the Study of the Universe. He's a member of about 30 academies, and as I mentioned, president of the International Astronomical Union, which was unheard of for a Soviet scientist at the time. He is also an honorary international member of, this is all the room that I had. There are more. So he was well thought of in professional circles. And again, as I say, he was a very kind, gentle man. People the world over loved him. A lot of time your geniuses are not so easy to get along with. This was a genius that was easy to get along with and was beloved by everyone. So hopefully that hopefully this makes you guys a little more aware of Ambartsumian and what he did. Chandra Sekhar wrote, "The only other astronomer of the century who compares with Ambartsumian in his consistency and devotion to astronomy is Professor Jan Oort." Chandra Sekhar knew all of them. He knew Hubble. He knew Edward Emerson Barnard. He knew Einstein. He knew all of the astronomers of the era. In his opinion, these two individuals stood above all of them. Jan Oort, who Ambartsumian looked up to, wrote that, "I have ceased being surprised at how one after another of Ambartsumian's hypotheses, which he offered prophetically many years ago, has been confirmed." He basically said, "I'm tired of doubting him." He says, "In my opinion, the most important contribution of Soviet scientists to astronomy has been the research by Ambartsumian on the role of the nuclei of galaxies in their evolution." Alan Sandage wrote a similar article, which I didn't include for length. This was his 80th birthday party. All the outstanding leaders in astrophysics and astronomy showed up. And Chandra Sekhar said, at this party, says, "He is an astronomer. There can be no more than 2 or 3 astronomers in this century who can look back on a life so worthily devoted to the progress of astronomy." And here we have Ambartsumian in the clouds. And here he is tearing apart the old theory of stellar evolution, where he just completely changed the way we think about stars and how stars evolved. He died in 1996, and he is buried next to the Grand 102-inch telescope tower. Truly one of the most amazing astronomers, astrophysics of the 20th century, or really of any century, Victor Ambartsumian, which is why I did this program. The man, I was blown away with him last year when I was doing the Markarian stuff. But if you want to find out more about him, this is an excellent book, which I have. It's available. And there's half a dozen other books also that are written by Ambartsumian. This is the one that I have, and it's just full of information. Also full of math, if you're really good at math, because he was a math wizard, and there's a lot of it in there. All right, a little bit about the surveys, and this is going to be a very little bit because this is what I talked about last year. The ultraviolet surveys, the Byurakan surveys that Ambert Soumian started, he turned it over to Benjamin Markarian, and the first survey was completed in 1980 using a low dispersion prism, which completely covered the back of the focal plane of the 1 meter Schmidt telescope. It was low dispersion because they wanted to be able to pick out the emission line spectra from the absorption lines. And if it was detailed, they wouldn't be able to do that. Kasarian Misha Kasarian did a separate survey starting in 1970 and 76, and he discovered something like 703 emission galaxies. And then the second Byurakan survey was started in 78, completed in 91, and published after Markarian's death in 2005. In total, they discovered 4,084 UV excess galaxies with emission line spectrum. When they started, there was a couple of three dozen. After it was all said and done, they came up with over 4,000. 1,700 ultraviolet stars, discovered almost 600 quasars, and about 10 blazars, which is typically a quasar with a jet pointed right at us. This is what the PRISM survey looked like. Every star, every image on the plane would have a spectrum. And from that, they could pick out the ones with ultraviolet emission. There were some 20 million of these objects in the whole survey, and it's still to this day the largest spectroscopic database in the world. I mentioned earlier, it has been digitized. It's free to the astronomical public. It takes 360 gigabytes to incorporate it. But it is freely available, that Byurakan made available. One thing that the survey did was it defined Seyfert galaxies. It defined them into Seyfert type 1 and Seyfert type 2. The Seyfert 1 galaxies are more energetic, and this is the only slide I've got like this because I covered this in detail last year, but you can see the spectral lines are widened because there's more activity in the center. The type 2 Seyfert galaxies are not as energetic as the type 1 Seyfert galaxies. So they were defined by the Doppler widths of the emission structure. And again, if these are all emission lines, which before these guys started with this, galaxies didn't have or weren't supposed to have emission lines. The morphology, the nuclei of these galaxies, and those of you that have been looking at them, you see the nucleus is stellar, star-like. Some of them are very bright, some of them are not so bright. But all of these galaxies have this type of structure in the middle. That is the ultraviolet emission that I'm talking about. They can be star-shaped, they can be a binary nuclei, they can be nuclei with jets. All of these qualify as what we call UV type galaxies. And it can be either from the active feeding black hole in the center, or from what we call a starburst phenomenon, where you've got massive stars, massive O and B type stars that are literally exploding, Wolf-Rayet stars that are throwing out material, a lot of material, and that will create these UV galaxies as well. This is Ambert Soumian and Markarian, the two of them working. There's Markarian, there's Ambert Soumian. In the last 30 years, there's been over 1,500 scientific papers written about these objects, and the work continues. 30 minutes. Lord. All right, we're going to speed things up. Marat Arakelian was one of their best scientists. He was a brilliant, extremely clever individual. McCallion said he wasn't always friendly with people, but he was one of their best scientists. He died at the age, at a very young age of 54, of a heart attack. Had he not died, he would be one of their best, considered one of their best scientists. He determined quasars have extragalactic origin. He is best known for his Eraclian galaxies, which those of you are enjoying that are looking at the advanced list. 621 galaxies of high surface brightness. In his lifetime, he published over 100 papers, and some of the other scientists over there were jealous of him because he was absolutely brilliant, some of the work that he did. And his premise behind the Eraclian galaxies was, is there a correlation between high surface brightness galaxies and active galactic nuclei? As it turns out, he found that these galaxies do have emission line structure like the UV excess galaxies. So the answer to that is yes. These high surface brightness galaxies are active, have some tremendous amount of activity taking place inside. Only 4% of galaxies qualified. To be considered a high surface brightness galaxy, the surface brightness had to be at least 22 magnitudes per square arc second. There were exceptions, but not too many, as calculated by Eraclian. Here at the Texas Star Party, we're looking at galaxies that are extremely distant. Some of these galaxies are the most distant one is 345 million light years away. That's a very, very far distance to be able to see structure such as these active galactic nuclei in the center. This is a sample of Eraclian galaxies. What do you guys see that's prevalent in all of them? Right in the center, absolutely. Here's a couple that we have on the list, and I'll go through some of these real quickly. But in general, all of them, this is a good representation of what they look like. A very active core with a much fainter halo around it. Eraclian 308, very interesting object in that you've got two rotating disks that rotate counter clockwise to each other in varying degrees, stars and gas. One's going this way, one's going the opposite direction. Eraclian 542, we looked at this the other night. This little object here, they're not sure what it is. It's either another galaxy, it's something expulged out of this galaxy, could be a superimposed object. They're really not sure what that object is. But we were able to see both of them the other night. This is somewhat a controversial item. I went with the NASA Extragalactic Database. The NED database says that NGC 5536 is Eraclian 444. The folks over at SIMBAD says this jobby, NGC 5541, is Eraclian 444. The professionals don't always agree, which is what I found out with my Megastar days. But I went with what the NED database has to say about it. This is unusual in that this is a spiral. It's a spiral galaxy, but it's also a radio galaxy. Most radio galaxies are elliptical. Eraclian 487, a classic Eraclian type UV excess galaxy, where the core, what takes place in the center of the galaxy, dominates the visual portion of the galaxy. And in Eraclian 532, there's a lot been written about this object, a tremendous amount of available literature that's out there. And when you look at it, it's kind of bland. It's pretty much equally lit across. But nevertheless, it's an interesting interesting object. Lots of star forming, lots of star formation taking place in this galaxy. All right, Kasserian. Misha Kasserian did a separate survey while Benjamin Markarian was doing his, and he came up with 706 galaxies that were emitting ultraviolet excess. These two surveys did not overlap one another. He used the same 1 meter Schmidt telescope, but he did the spectra. The galaxies that they found with the 1 meter Schmidt telescope, he did his spectra here at McDonald Observatory and on the 200-inch telescope. So he did a lot of work over here in America, which in a sense for a while made the Kasserian survey more famous than the Markarian survey, simply because some of the work was done over here. These are the Kasserian galaxies, and I was going to ask you what is common here, but it's the same answer, brighter centers. And this is a nice object that we looked at the other night that I'll talk about in just a second. I did this last year, so I'm going to go over this kind of quickly. But what makes an active galactic nuclei, about 60% of them, is a feeding black hole in the center of the galaxy. Depending on our angle, our viewpoint, how deep can we see into that center of that galaxy depends on how active that galaxy appears to be from our perspective. So if we're looking straight down the jet, for instance, this would be a blazar. If we're looking from this angle, this would be a type 1 Seyfert galaxy or a radio loud quasar. If we're looking from a lesser angle where we see less deep into the interior, we see it as a type 2 Seyfert type object. So it's a matter of perspective. And essentially, you've got the black hole, you've got an accretion disk, and you've got very hot clouds moving at a high rate of speed. These clouds moving at a high rate of speed are the wide Doppler-shifted emission structure that we see in the spectrum when we look at this perspective. When we look further out, these are higher, further away from the center, more tenuous clouds moving at a lower rate of speed. So when we get a spectra of this, we get narrow line emission lines because they're moving at a slower pace, and we get forbidden radiation because it's more tenuous. It's not as dense gas as what we get in here. So we can look at the spectra and we can tell what type of orientation we've got on that galaxy with respect to our view of the galaxy and how deep into the interior we can see. And that determines whether it's a Seyfert type 2, type 1, quasar, BLA sort of object, or whatever. And these are all, of course, Kasserian galaxies that you guys are looking at. So these galaxies all being active versus a normal galaxy, approximately 10% of all galaxies are active in some way. 40% have starburst nuclei, meaning 60% are feeding black hole type scenarios that we're looking at. Only 2% are isolated. Most of these are interacting with other galaxies, and there's a wide variety of morphological types. Elliptical, most of them, a good portion of them, are elliptical or lenticular galaxies, but there are enough of them that are spiral galaxies as well. And this is some of the Kasserian galaxies that we've been looking at. I'll run through these fairly quickly for time. But Kasserian 119, interesting article, object. Kasserian 194, some of these, we were looking at this the other night. Barbara was looking at this, I think, night before last as well. We could not see the tail. But you can see the two galaxies, and this one is brighter and larger than this one, and there's a tremendous amount of star formation taking place between these two galaxies that are interacting. And both of these are putting out a prodigious amount of radiation and energy in the form of UV excess galaxies, which is why they're called that. Kasserian 142 is a nice, slightly tilted face on barred spiral. And this is an interesting object, Kasserian 198. This is the 198 here. I didn't include 199 in the list. Visually, this kind of blends into this. And this is a low surface brightness galaxy. It's not real bright. This is a star of about 13th magnitude, and it kind of gets in the way. If you look very closely, you can see this, and that is a Type 2 Seyfert galaxy. So it has some pop on its own. Cassarian 460 is a beautiful galaxy, as is Cassarian 390. Cassarian 390 visually looks about like that. No central brightening, just massive amounts of star formation taking place. All right, compact galaxy groups. I've got some Shackbosian clusters on there. I will tell you guys, please try to see them. I had some telescope problems of my own, and I was unable to try and see some of these Cassarian galaxies prior to having to publish for the Texas Star Party. They're very difficult. They're too difficult. I would not have included them had I have looked at them. So those of you that are doing the list, try to see it. If you don't see it, mark it off as not seen, but count it, which means now you only need to do 16. At least try to see them, though. all right, a little bit about compact galaxy groups. The first one was discovered by Edward Jean Marie Stefan in 1877, which we know as Stefan's Quintet. We know now that NGC 7320 is a foreground object, and that this object over here is the real member, is the real fifth member of the group. 71 years later, Carl Keenan Seyfert discovered what we now know as Seyfert's Sextet, a very energetic object. However, it's not a sextet either. That's not a member, and that is material that's thrown out of this. It's not a true sextet either. But these were the first two galaxy groups, compact galaxy groups, discovered. From then, we have a plethora of them, but Dr. Romelia Shackbosian of Byurakan was the first one to actually come up with a catalog, which she did so in 1957, and she was a she. There is some discussion as to who Shackbosian was, and I've been talking with Dr. Michaelian, and he agreed there's very little information out there about her. I sent him something, told her, says she's a rock star of astronomy. All these other people with catalogs are famous. What's wrong with her at Byurakan? And he said he would, when he finished the trip, the business trip he's on now, that he is going to change that. There'll be some literature. If you access the Byurakan website, you'll be able to find out more information about her. Her husband was an engineer who was in charge of building all the components for Byurakan Observatory. But she was the scientist in the family. Dr. Hubble, Edwin Hubble, was responsible for the Palomar Sky Survey. Vorontsov Velyaminov, his Atlas of Interacting Galaxies, he called these galaxies nests, but he published his list. Fritz Zwicky had his CGCG catalog of galaxies and clusters of galaxies. Fritz was a very colorful individual. He gave grad students hell out in California. He was famous for calling anyone who disagreed with him, he referred to them as spherical bastards. Because they were bastards anyway, from any angle that you looked at them. You know? So he was a very colorful individual, but he also came up with the concept of dark matter back in the 30s, way before anybody thought something like that existed. And then, of course, Halton Chip Arp, who I was privileged to get to know twice. Barbara was able to get him here at TSP twice. He passed away a little over a year ago, unfortunately. Very nice man. And then Paul Hickson, who also has been here twice. And Hickson is known for his Hickson 100 galaxy clusters, where he looked at every POS print and came up with 100 clusters. These clusters are studied constantly, and the reason is because these are the fundamental building blocks of large-scale galaxy structures. They're the ideal laboratory for studying young galaxies and how galaxies interact and gravitationally react with each other. And this on the right is the Shackbazian 26, which is the brightest of the clusters that we had a look at. Hrant Tovmasian is a noted expert on galaxy clusters. He has written a lot of papers on young compact clusters and how they interact with each other. And from 1979 to 86, he was the vice director of Byurakan. I've got some papers written by him, and they're all very well done. Dr. Shackbazian was not the one to discover Shackbazian 1. It was discovered by Mr. Ambartsumian. But he turned the project over to her, and she took it from there. And they looked at over 200 pos prints, some 18% of the sky, and came up with this cluster of Shackbazian galaxies that we look at today. 377 of them that she cataloged. Cluster members were 5 to 15. The clusters are all isolated. The majority are ordinary E or SO lenticular type galaxies. The apparent magnitudes are usually pretty faint. The groups were compact, and the galaxy members themselves were compact, and they have a relatively high surface brightness. Initially, they thought a lot of these were distant stars because they were so compact, they looked like stars. But we now know that they truly are galaxies. There are some differences in the Higson and the Shackbazian clusters, and they're not really sure why this is. But the Higson groups, 50% are spiral galaxies, whereas the Shackbazians are only 15% spirals. Elliptical galaxies in the Higsons are 40%, and in Shackbazians are 77%. Those are real differences. It's thought the Higson groups are young, whereas the Shackbazian groups are older groups, but compact galaxy groups are not supposed to stay together long because they'll gravitationally remove each other from the group. So they're not really sure why the Shackbazian galaxy groups are able to stay together as long as apparently they have. But that's the thinking right now, is the Higson groups are young, the Shackbazian groups are older in time. And for those of you who don't know the Higson clusters, this is what they look like. They're nearer, they're closer, we can see more detail in them, whereas the Shackbazians look like so. Shackbazian 26, this is probably the easiest thing for you to see. It looks like an elongated edge-on galaxy. And if you see that, you're looking at something that's almost 2 billion light years away. We used to think the Corona Borealis cluster was distant because it was 1 billion years ago. Well, now we've got stuff that's 2 billion years away to look at. some of the other clusters on the list, you can look at those magnitudes. This is why I'm telling you, take a look at it. If you don't see it, check it off and go to the next thing. Because the brightest galaxy here is over 17th magnitude. Shackbazian 154, the brightest member here is almost 17th magnitude. So again, very distant objects. Shackbazian 376, we looked at this one last night. This one here is not particularly difficult in a 36-inch telescope anyway. And I'm claiming this one here as well. But I think we could see a couple of galaxies in this one. Tovmasian said that the group was exclusively composed of spirals. A later group said no, that it was composed of early type elliptical lenticular galaxies. It's been proven now pretty much that Tovmasian was correct. These are spiral galaxies, which is somewhat unusual. All right, Cometary Nebula. This is an area that we don't have anything on the observing list this year, but Byurakan is in the forefront of discovering and studying cometary nebula. These are all reflection nebula.
They emit little or no light. The light they do emit is reflected light, which means it's very difficult to observe those in a telescope. And they're almost always associated with some kind of a star-like condensation, something like a T Tauri star or a Wolf Rayet star, something that is throwing out material. And the material that's being thrown out is what is being illuminated, reflectivity, or reflected by that star. They fall into four different morphological subsets, T Tauri-like stars, fan-shaped nebulous appendages like commas and hourglass structures, where we only see half of a structure that's putting out an hourglass-type structure. We only see half of it, half of a bipolar emission, if you will. Elma Parsamian is in the forefront of this. She also worked with Vahi Petrosian, who was very helpful with me. She put out a catalog of 106 cometary nebula that had never been known before. She also put out a catalog of 534 stars having hydrogen alpha emission lines in the Orion Nebula. And she is still at Byurakan and still working strong. She's also doing a lot of work in archaeoastronomy, astronomy, the history of astronomy of the Middle East, and she's done a lot of fascinating work with that as well. And this is some of the cometary nebula. Most of these are up at a time that's not favorable for observing from the Texas Star Party, so I kind of stayed away from them. Besides that, they're pretty difficult to see visually anyway. This just gives you an idea of some of the cometary nebula. And this is Parsamian 21, which I didn't have on the list, but we have I've had it on previous list of the year that we did nebula. This was on there. It's a FU Orionis type star, a type object. And they don't really know if it's a low mass pre-main sequence star, intermediate age, or a post-AGB star that's about to go planetary nebula. They have, however, due to the silicate emission that is taking place, they're kind of narrow it down. They think it's an intermediate age star at the moment. So that's, anyway, the best guess. These knots are moving outward at up to 330 miles an hour. It's not particularly difficult to see visually in a telescope. It's in Aquila. It comes up a little late in the morning, but those are the coordinates. And then Dr. Gulbadagian, he is also one of the top scientists at Byurakan, and he specializes in cometary nebula as well. And I didn't include this one because we had Gulbadagian's nebula on a previous advanced list when we did the nebula program. But this just shows you how these things change. This is what it looks like today. This is what it looked like in 1952. As the star throws out more material or less material, it brightens, it dims, it changes the shape and the brightness of the nebula itself. And it can change in as little as just a few weeks. But he's a very active worker at Byurakan to this day. So far, he's published 76 professional papers. And then the last astronomer I'm talking about over there is another brilliant individual. He worked with Dr. Ambartsumian. He was responsible for helping Ambartsumian set up Byurakan Observatory in 1946. Grigor Gurzadyan, a very influential individual. These are some of the books. These are five of the books that he has written. He has done a lot of work with the Soviet space program, designing missile and rocket components and in the orbital observatories. He has done a tremendous amount of work with planetary nebula. He came up with a whole separate scheme of how do we categorize planetary nebula. In the 60s, he predicted the dynamics and the magnetic fields of planetary nebula, what they should be and what they will be in the future. And it wasn't actually discovered until 2005 that his the paper that he wrote in the 60s was correct. He's authored theoretical papers on flare stars, interstellar matter, binary stars. He's done spectra on thousands of stars and done a tremendous amount of work on planetary nebula. And I won't go into this in too much great detail, but he came up with a whole separate way of categorizing planetaries by the excitation class of the nebula, specifically the hydrogen emission and the oxygen emission, using that as a ratio. The N1, N2 is what we know as nebulium 1, nebulium 2, before we knew that that was oxygen 3 emission of 49, 59, and 5007 angstroms in the oxygen 3 emission line. So he used, for low excitation, he used the O3 emission and the H beta ratio. For high excitation planetaries, he used the oxygen 3 emission, but he used the helium 2 emission, which is a much stronger emission. Helium is a noble element, so it's harder to ionize or energize helium than, say, hydrogen. So he used that for his high excitation ratios, and he came up with this, where he categorized when you do the math out, depending on where it lands, if like 0.15 is a category 1, it's a very low emission planetary nebula. Anything 0.5 or above is a very high emission nebula. And in general, the high emission nebula are larger, and the central star in the center is much hotter than, say, a category 1. And this is a beautiful, beautiful way of categorizing planetaries that he came up with, which had never been done before. Planetaries are hard to pin down because there's so many variabilities that go on. The central star variability is changing. The halo is changing. The halo is expanding. Things are constantly changing in planetaries, so it's hard to categorize a planetary in one sense or another. This one does it and does it very well. And okay. And surprisingly, just about the last slide, with 3 minutes. This is a listing of some of the discoveries that have been made in this amazing place in Byurakan, starting in 1947 and continuing to the present day. I put the last one in compilation and publication, the catalog of 1,103 faint Byurakan objects that Dr. McAlien is doing. And so these are some of the scientific first that were done at this observatory. Dr. Ambart Soumian, he wrote somewhat late in life, he said, "The astronomy of the 20th century undergoes a grand revolution comparable with the Copernicus epoch. It is a result of the discovery in the universe of new types of objects, galaxies, active nuclei, producing immense explosion, quasar stellar radio sources, the quasars, and others. The phenomenon occurring in these celestial bodies proves to be totally uncommon and require a radical revision of many conceptions and theories in astrophysics, cosmogony, and cosmology. It also calls into question the universality of the presently known fundamental laws of physics." He said, "I do not exclude that the study of the universe will lead to a new revolution in the whole system of physics in the near future." That's exciting, and I think that's why all of us are in this room, because the science of astronomy is changing almost daily, and Ambart Soumian knew that. My thought, and I asked Dr. McAlien about this, in my impression, the Byurakan Observatory may well be the most prolific observatory for discoveries related to astronomy and theoretical astrophysics of any observatory anywhere in the world. I asked Dr. McAlien what he thought of that, and he answered, he says, essentially, I agree. He says, "I have always been proud to be affiliated with Byurakan." He says, "I cannot, however, answer
for all the other observatories in the world. He was getting modest, in other words. He says, I'll leave it up to you, Larry, as to how you want to present this to your audience with a smiley face. But I do believe this to be the case. So I'll leave you with a beautiful view of our night sky here from the Texas Star Party. And with this final thought, isn't it really wonderful to be an astronomer? How fortunate we are that we get to do this at least once a year here, but we get to do this with our telescopes any night of the year that we want to. Everything that they point these telescopes at today is a new discovery, and we get to be part of that. It's fascinating, and I just absolutely love it, and I know you guys do too. So I want to thank you very much.